Good morning. Can I remind members of the COVID-related measures that are in place and that face coverings should be worn when moving around the Chamber and across the Holyrood campus? The first item of business is general questions. In order to get as many people in as possible, I would prefer short and succinct questions and answers to match. Question one has been withdrawn. Question two, I call Graeme Simpson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what the latest estimate is of the public cost of procuring the ferries MV Glensannox and Hull 802.
Cabinet Secretary Kate Forbes.
The turnaround director of Ferguson Marine updated the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee on the delivery timetable and budget for vessels 801 and 802 on the 30th of September 2021. And the cost to complete the vessels remains the same as was reported in the turnaround director's December 2019 report to Parliament, between £110.3 million and £114.3 million.
Graeme Simpson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. The turnaround director, Tim Hare, said in that same letter that Ferguson uses seven different data systems that don't talk to each other. In other words, no one knows what anyone else is doing. Is it any wonder that these vessels are so late and so over budget? Seamal's just ordered a small, slow, second-hand ferry from Norway, the diesel-powered MV Upna, at an overall cost of £9 million. It was for sale at under £6 million. So can the Cabinet Secretary explain what that gap's for? Is it just for livery? And why are we going for gas-guzzling cast-offs and not going for the same kind of eco-friendly ferries that the Norwegians are buying?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I confess to having constituency interests as much as having government interests in the vessel that has just been procured, because it frees up the MV Kursk to go back to the service for which it was designed between Malig and Armadale, which has been met with great celebration in the communities of Slate and Malig. And I think it's important that the government looks at all options for ensuring that our lifeline vessels are secure and resilient. And I'm sure the member would join me in that. And that's where, when it comes to the future of the fleet, that is £580 million committed over the next few years to ensure that we do invest in ferry infrastructure right across the West Coast.
Alistair Allen.
As the Cabsec knows, vessel 802 is intended to serve both Loch Maddy and Tarbert. However, there have been calls from the communities in North Uist and Harris for each vessel, or for each area, sorry, ultimately to have a dedicated vessel. What consideration is the Scottish Government giving to this question, which has been raised now for some years?
Cabinet Secretary.
How actively he represents his constituency on these matters. Consideration of vessel replacement and deployment options is an ongoing process, and I know that my colleague Graeme Day was pleased to meet members of the North Uist and Harris communities during his recent visit to the Outer Hebrides, and I understand that the future option of an additional vessel on these routes, at least during peak summer, has been identified for further assessment as part of the work on the island's connectivity plan and its investment programme, and I hope that that work will continue at pace, and I'm sure the member will have the opportunity to represent his constituents on those issues.
Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that the only way for the future of shipbuilding in Port Glasgow and Greenock and Inverclyde to continue was for the yard to be taken into public ownership, and the Tories' record of hammering shipbuilding communities is there for all to see, then nobody should listen to the Tories when it comes to saving shipbuilding jobs?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the member is right in reminding the Chamber that it was the efforts of this government that saved Ferguson Marine from closure, saved more than 300 jobs supporting the communities of Inverclyde in the face of a decade of Conservative cuts, and ultimately ensured that two much-needed vessels will be completed and that the yard has a future. We are investing in the future. We are supporting the yard to be more efficient, to be more competitive, and ultimately able to win contracts on the merits of their success. We will always back the shipbuilding industry in Scotland, delivering for Inverclyde, but also for our island communities that rely on those lifeline services.
Question number 3, Karen Adam.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to address the problem of gulls in urban areas in North East and Moray.
Minister Mary McCallum.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government supports gull management in Moray and North East Scotland through Nature Scot and others whose role it is to provide advice regarding gull management and as the licensing authority to license gull management where necessary. Moray Council, I understand, has extended its voluntary nest and egg removal pilot and similar schemes are available to local authorities across Scotland.
Karen Adam.
I thank you for that answer. I recently held a meeting to discuss the issues that had arisen due to the prevalence of urban gulls in Banffshire and Buchan Coast. During the meeting, it was drawn to my attention that the most recent relevant Scottish Government research on the biodiversity of urban gulls is from 2006. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update to research on urban gulls and their management in Scotland.
Minister.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. And I was aware of the public meeting that the member undertook. I understand that Nature Scot were represented and spoke to some of your constituents, and I heard it went very well. A current UK seabird census, which was organised by the Joint Nature Conservation Committee, includes aims to estimate the populations of species that breed in urban environments. And the findings of this research will help me and officials inform future policy in dealing with urban gull populations.
Question number 4, Michelle Thompson.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it plans to publish the James Hutton Institute report on the impact on human health and the environment arising from the spreading of sewage sludge on land.
Minister Mary McCallum.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. Yes, I'm pleased to inform the member that we intend to publish the report this month.
Michelle Thompson.
Thank you. My constituents in Falkirk East are anxious to see the publication of this report. The spreading of sewage sludge has been raised as a concern to my predecessor, Angus MacDonald, and now to me. The smell and inconvenience generates multiple complaints, but it is the potential risk to human health that is most concerning. Can the Minister confirm if the Scottish Government considers there are risks to human and animal health of sewage sludge when used as the soil conditioner, and advise what recent assessment they have undertaken on the viral, heavy metal and bacterial loads in sewage sludge?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm absolutely aware of the concerns of the member's constituents and indeed of the member, and the Government take matters of human health and indeed environmental quality very seriously. Indeed, a full review of the legislation and guidance relevant to the storage and spreading of sludge was undertaken in 2016, and that more recent piece of work, which I referred to and which is going to be published this month, will help us carefully consider the situation as of 2021. The spreading of sewage sludge on land is a long-established practice and is an effective way of recovering value and avoiding waste. The practice is very tightly regulated by the Scottish Environment Protection Agency, although separately issues of odour, which I know are some of the concerns of the member's constituents, are the responsibility of local authority. And I can just assure the member that SEPA will never hesitate to take enforcement against anyone who is not complying with the current regulations for storage and spreading.
Question number 5, Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its position is on whether the Swedish national system of collective rent bargaining through a national union of tenants would help to address any housing issues in Scotland.
Minister Patrick Harvey.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and thank Maggie Chapman for that question. We're currently considering a wide range of information and evidence on rent controls and other issues that will be part of our New Deal for tenants. This will include examining international comparisons, Sweden and other countries, and that will help to inform our thinking as we progress policy development in this important area of work.
Maggie Chapman.
Can I thank the Minister for that response and pleased to note the work that is ongoing. It is clear that we have a lot of work to do to ensure we have the right data from the right people and places so that we adopt appropriate mechanisms to set and review rent levels, and I'm very keen to ensure that tenants will play a central role in these discussions. Their voices and concerns must be at the heart of their new deal. And so we need to hear from those with lived experience. Can I ask the Minister, how will tenants' voices be involved in shaping this strategy? And will he join me in Dundee to speak to members of Living Rent and hear about their experiences of a tenants' union?
Minister?
Yeah, absolutely. I think the basic thrust of this question is really important. Tenants' voices need not only to be heard, but also to be effective. We've begun work on gathering tenants' views through partnership working with the Joseph Rowntree Foundation. And I know that around the country there are other examples. Glasgow City Council, for example, is working to ensure that tenants' voices are heard in its deliberations. And I recently met with Living Rent, one of the first stakeholder groups that I met with when I took on this role. Living Rent have done extraordinary work on making sure that tenants' voices are both heard and effective. I'd be very happy to meet with local groups in Dundee and elsewhere, and I would encourage the member to contact my office to arrange that.
Call Mercedes Vialba.
The pandemic has caused a sharp rise in rent arrears, which now stand at over £3 million in Dundee and nearly £8 million in Aberdeen. Yet support for landlords was prioritised, who received around 14 times more in financial support than tenants. So when will the Scottish Government start to support tenants facing rent arrears, given that no money has yet been paid out from their £10 million tenant hardship grant fund?
Minister.
I'm grateful to the member. I think she probably is aware that this was debated long and hard across a range of different political parties during the last session as we developed the emergency legislation, and a wide range of views were expressed about the prioritisation of support. We now only recently have the Tenant Hardship Loan Fund replaced with a grant fund, so I hope the member is willing to let that system be operational before she judges whether it's a success or not. It's only just come in to replace the loan fund. And I think many voices, mine and others, including from the Labour Party, quite rightly criticised the idea that loans alone were going to meet the needs of tenants. And that's why a grant fund has been agreed by the Scottish Government and put in place.
Siobhan Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I ask the Minister what he thinks the Scottish Government can learn from our neighbours across Europe in its approach to fair and socially just housing?
Minister.
I think there's a great deal to learn from neighbours in other European countries. A crucial part of our work on developing policies in this area, rent controls and the wider New Deal for tenants, will be to listen to and learn from the experience from countries like the Republic of Ireland, Sweden and Germany, and to carefully listen to and consider their experience. And that could include looking at the role of tenants' unions, again, an important way of shifting power in the relationship between landlord and tenants. Tenants' unions could play a much bigger role in that in Scotland. And we're also working with academia to consider alternative approaches to rent control that could be considered in the Scottish context. And I thank the member for her interest.
Question number six, Russell Findlay.
To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to recent comments from Cancer Research UK regarding cancer survival rates in Scotland.
Minister Marie Todd.
Despite the recent pressures of the COVID-19 pandemic, cancer remains a priority. Our NHS staff have worked incredibly hard over the last year to ensure the majority of cancer treatment and care have continued. We've treated more patients within the 62-day standard this quarter compared to the same time in both 2019 and 2020. Over the next 5 years, we'll invest £40 million to support cancer services, focusing on the most challenged cancer pathways. We're investing £20 million to support our Detect Cancer Early programme to improve public awareness of the signs of cancer. And additionally, the £114.5 million cancer plan will roll out innovative treatments to improve services and ensure access to care is equitable across Scotland.
Russell Findlay.
The charity says, and I quote, "Far too many people are waiting far too long for treatment," and again quoting, "Chronic shortages in staff and equipment predate COVID." They also say cancer survival rates could start going back for the first time. Another charity, Breast Cancer Now, says that over 1,000 Scottish women are living with undiagnosed breast cancer. Cancer Research want a firm commitment to tackle staff shortages and investment in equipment. Minister, will you today meet these commitments to ensure that no one waits too long for the vital treatment they need?
Minister.
So early diagnosis is absolutely vital, and we have invested in the NHS workforce. Staffing levels in Scotland's NHS have reached a new record high after an increase of 5,000 full-time equivalent staff in the last year. Since 2006, there's been an 87.7% increase in consultant oncologists, a 57.4% increase in consultant radiologists, and our NHS recovery plan commits more than £1 billion of targeted investment for the recovery and the renewal of our health service. As well as investing in the workforce, we're investing in new technologies, and we are making sure that those technologies are available around the country. So we've invested £5.6 million this year to support additional mobile MRI scanners, 3CT scanners, which are operational throughout Scotland, and we've invested in mobile units located in NHS Highland and NHS Tayside to increase capacity. We are working really hard on this issue, and I expect that we will meet demand as the charity is requesting.
Carol Walken.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Minister will be aware that uptake of cervical screening tests in Scotland's most deprived areas is 63% compared to 74% in the least deprived. This is totally unacceptable health inequality that leaves women from deprived areas at greater risk of developing serious health conditions. So I would like to ask the Minister today, what is the Scottish Government doing to encourage more women from deprived areas to attend their appointments? And will the Minister outline today a timescale for when the Scottish Government expect to have closed that alarming gap?
Minister.
I thank the member for that question. The member draws attention to an issue which impacts on screening more generally, not just in cervical cancer screening, in that there is an inequality in terms of uptake of those screening offers, which are so vital. Cervical cancer is largely preventable, and it's so vital to encourage people to come along and get their cervical screening in order to prevent cancer before it's even happened. We have a programme in place to improve access to screening, where there is a whole variety of work. Some specific work in cervical screening is to help people who cannot leave their house, for example, to access screening, to look at the barriers that are in place for each individual who is not accepting the offer on screening, and to ensure that we take away those barriers and that they can access it. I can update you in writing after this session in all the range of work that we're doing, but it is something that we are really focused on improving because we recognise the impact that that can have on citizens in Scotland.
Question number 7, Christine Graham.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what assistance it is giving to maintain bus services in Midlothian South, Tweeddale and Lauderdale constituency.
Minister Patrick Harvey.
Thank you. The Scottish Government has supported bus operators to maintain services through the COVID support grant and the COVID support grant restart, while use by customers has been depressed due to the impacts of the pandemic. Up to £210 million in emergency funding has been made available since June 2020 to support services across Scotland, including the Midlothian South, Tweeddale and Lauderdale constituency.
Christine Graham.
Thank you. Not an easy constituency to name. Minister, I'm aware that despite that additional support from the Scottish Government to bus companies, COVID has had a substantial and continuing impact on services, with some being cut. But can I ask, as we enter COVID recovery, if the Scottish Government will prioritise when they're funding providers, this being conditional on the return of some direct services, such as the Borders General Hospital, the Royal Edinburgh and Ashley Ainslie, serving my constituents both as patients and as employees?
Minister.
Thank you, and I thank the member for that follow-up question. I'm sure it reflects concerns that are felt in her constituency and elsewhere. It's a condition of our COVID funding that participating operators plan services and keep them under review in consultation with their transport authorities, having regard to services are required to minimise public transport connectivity disadvantages, including for island and rural communities. Similar requirements would continue under any recovery funding for bus. However, demand for bus services is only currently at 65% of pre-COVID levels on average across Scotland, and it will take some time to return to pre-COVID levels. So bus operators and local transport authorities will have to make decisions about where to deploy services to meet current and hopefully growing passenger demand, which may be different from the pre-pandemic travel patterns.
Thank you. That concludes general questions.